I actually never used manual lenses with any camera I had, but recently Perger sent me two of them for my Fujifilm X-T4. This is the 12mm f2 from Perger and the 7 Artisans 35mm f0.95, so a lot of shallow depth of field here. And I'm actually quite surprised by these lenses when I did a few test shots, so I would say let's do some more test shots here and talk about how they perform. The thing that I was most worried about when it comes to manual focus lenses is obviously the focus. Like, I'm used to pressing the AF on button there to get a focus quick, and then it locks there. I sometimes do slight adjustments with the focus ring if I have to, or focus transitions, etc. So I'm used to that, but only having a manual lens, I was always a bit skeptical. But what I didn't think about before was that manual focus lens does not only mean that they don't have autofocus, but it also means that they are optimized for manual focus. And what that means is that you can turn the focus wheel really nicely, like you don't have to scroll that much until you get your subject in focus, as it is with all the autofocus lenses. So as you can see here, here's the hard stop. When I turn it back, here's the hard stop. It's not even a full turn for the full zoom range, and that actually makes focusing on these lenses really easy. And even if I tried to follow Robbie, for example, in the shot that you see here right now, you can actually see that it is actually quite well. It's not perfect though, because I'm not a professional focus puller. Like, it's my first lenses where I do that, but it was a lot easier to do that than I imagined. And actually it's the same thing here on the f2. Like, when I turn it, it's also less than one turn. It feels like half a turn, probably a little bit more. It's really good. So I'm quite impressed by these focus wheels, and I think actually this is a good thing, because sometimes you actually want to have a manual focus pull, especially when it comes to focus transitions, as you see here for example. And yeah, that's just good to have something like that. And aside from that, they're also quite cheap, of course. Let's talk about the individual lenses. Let's start with the 35mm f0.95. And on this lens, I actually don't have much or anything bad to say about it. Maybe the weight, it is a bit heavy for how small it is. Like, it's not actually heavy if you compare it to some full frame lenses or whatever. But if you have it in your hand, it feels a bit heavier than you expect, which is probably because of the metal design. And that, on the other hand, is a good thing, because it's really well built. Even if I take it off, you can see like the back is all metal. That's great. So overall, a really nice lens. And the toner looks really nice too. It's obvious at 0.95 that you get nice toner. Should be around 1.5 on a full frame camera equivalent. But the thing is also, like, toner is, or bokeh is, never the same on every lens, even if you have a low aperture. But here I must say it looks really smooth. Like, when you look for example on the Viltrox lenses, there the bokeh looks a bit more busy in the background, especially if you have bushes. But on this lens, it is really nice and smooth. So overall, a great lens. And I think especially for portrait shots, that's great, because on portrait you usually have a bit more time focusing, so if it takes a second longer, that's okay. So if autofocus is important for you, I would definitely consider getting the Viltrox lens, as it's also fairly inexpensive. But if bokeh is more important for you, you don't necessarily need autofocus, you're fine with manual, then that's definitely the lens to get. And let's talk about the 12mm f2 from Perger. And this lens also has a very nice full metal build quality. Even the sunshade here that comes with the lens is made of metal. On the 35mm there's actually no sunshade included, so you would have to buy one. But the only thing that I don't like about this lens here is that when you want to install the lens cap, it actually does not work when you have the sunshade on. So you first have to take the sunshade off and then you can attach it. Not a big issue, of course, no one would really care about it, but I oftentimes have it that I actually put my lens cap on and then the sunshade, or I just leave both on when I just walk a few meters and I want to protect the lens, etc. So it can get a bit in your way, even if it's not a big issue. And optically, I must say I like the look from this lens as well, but I had one little issue there, and that's when I tried astrophotography with it. Like, I tried to capture some stars from this viewpoint here actually a few weeks ago, and there I could not get the stars in focus. Like, I set it first to infinity focus, also pulled it a little bit back, but I was not able to get the stars in focus. I wrote with a support from Perga that also told me that I would have to set it like slightly before infinity and not completely to infinity, and maybe I just didn't dial it enough back, so I'm not really sure if it was my mistake or if it's about the lens. But what I also read in forums was that there are these three screws here around the lens, and you can loose the screws and then adjust the focus wheel manually. I don't really know how that works. I wouldn't trust myself doing that. That's why I don't do it. So maybe then you can get the stars in focus. I think there is an option for that. What I think this lens is definitely good for is for vlogging, for example. As you can see, it's a very small lens. It's also pretty light, so it's really nice to hold for vlogging. And the f2 also gives you a bit of a shallow depth of field, so you should be in the f3 full frame area, so close to f2.8, and that's a really nice look, especially considering that you're at about 18 millimeter equivalent when you add the 1.5 crop to the 12 millimeters. Okay, that's a little vlogging test here with the X-T4 and the 12 millimeter f2 lens from Perga. I must say sorry in advance because I forgot my Rode NTG microphone, and that's why the audio should be bad now, so I will keep that short. But just that you see, it actually looks pretty good. Get a little bit shallow depth of field, it could be more of course, but I think for an APS-C camera that's really nice at f2. And yeah, I mean, aside from that, focusing is actually quite easy. Definitely turn the peaking on, that helps a lot. Otherwise it's quite hard to see if you're actually in focus. The only thing that you really have to think about when you're in focus is that you should keep the arm lengths at about the same distance all the time, because otherwise you would get out of focus. So if I get a bit closer now, you can see I'm not in focus anymore. If I go back to where I was before, then I'm back in focus. But it's actually not a big issue, especially because this lens is pretty lightweight, so you can have your arm easily a bit farther away. And of course it depends a bit on your style of vlogging here, if you want to get this lens or not. I think this lens is best if you mostly talk and you don't get that much b-roll shots, because if you talk and you want to capture b-roll, then it's generally better to have a zoom lens so that you have different focal lengths covered with one lens. Also, this lens is great for studio like shots, like if you want to have a fixed camera set up in your studio with a wider angle, then that's definitely a good lens, because you can just leave it wherever it is and then you're always perfectly in focus. You don't have to readjust it all the time, etc. That's great. You can also fix that with tape so that the focus point is always at exactly the same point. And especially in the studio, it's even easier to focus because you can use an external monitor like the Atomos Ninja V, which also has focus peaking, so you perfectly see if you're in focus or not. And yeah, sorry again, I hope the audio quality is not too bad. So back to the main camera. So overall a great vlogging lens, and it's also great for landscape shots because of the wide angle. And if you now ask for the actual optical quality of those lenses regarding sharpness, etc., I'm not a photographer, I'm a videographer. For me, it's like, as long as it covers 4K, so about 8 megapixels, I'm totally happy with these lenses. And to be honest, which lens doesn't do it? And also, I don't have to really pixel peep the edges, because the edges are cut off when I film in 16x9 or 17x9 anyway. So it doesn't really matter for me, and that's why I don't do an in-depth review here where I really do some photos with some charts and I really look into those small details, because they don't matter for me. For me, it really only counts what footage I get straight off this camera. That's what I want to test, and for me that's totally fine. Generally, when I do landscape shots, I never use an open aperture, and I usually go at about 5.6 to 8 with all of my lenses. Doesn't matter if it's one of my bigger autofocus lenses or this one, so I suggest you to do the same. I do that anyway, and I would say the optical performance here of this lens is also pretty good for that. So let's come to a conclusion, and I can only say that both of these lenses positively surprised me. I will definitely try out to fix these issues with astrophotography on this lens more if I find a good solution, and I will leave that in the description of this video, because I think this is a great astrophotography lens. At f2, obviously want to have a bright aperture there, and at 12 millimeter you also capture a wide angle, which is always a problem with astrophotography when you want to photograph the Milky Way, for example. And it's the wider the lens is, the longer you can expose the shot without getting stars that are like more like lines and not round. So that's definitely good to have, and it would be nice nice if I can use this lens for this. Also, regarding the price of the 12mm lens, it's about $170 or something like that on a Perga website and on Amazon. So this is actually a very cheap lens, and if you're looking for a cheap and lightweight lens for vlogging, then that's the one to get. Definitely turn focus peaking on in your camera and set it to red for both lenses, because then when you turn the wheels, you can see very quickly what's in focus, and that speeds everything up, obviously. So that's just a little tip here to make it a bit easier. Aside from that, great optical qualities. I can definitely recommend getting those lenses. So I hope this video was helpful. If yes, then leave me a thumbs up, and also don't forget to hit subscribe and the bell notifications button for upcoming videos. I publish one or two videos every week, and I hope to see you in the next one.